The fourth is a question convention. Let me give you a couple of examples, personal examples of how I questioned convention, and each time it got me into trouble. But I think it was either a learning experience or it helped the project that I was involved in grow. The first example is, many years ago, the state party used to have a position called the third vice chair. I think they now call it the youth chair. And I recently got elected to that position. And we had the race for University of Michigan region was picking up. And at the time, this was the early 90s, speech codes, political correct codes, were sort of all the rave in all the colleges. All the colleges were passing these codes to basically not allow students to speak freely, whether on issues of affirmative action, or on issues of life, or on issues of the free market. Political correctness was having its heyday, and colleges were actually passing these strict speech codes. I went to both candidates for the University of Michigan region, asked them to sign a pledge. Please don't support any speech codes. And if you do, I'll endorse you. Well, the third vice position post in the previous time, or the most recent history, has simply been to be the emissary of the state party chair, to go out to college Republicans, fire them up, and do the state party's bidding. Well, one of the candidates that I asked wouldn't sign it, because he wasn't sure what the speech codes were, and he was a little concerned, and he didn't know what to do, so he wouldn't sign it. So I called them, at the time we had 17 district chairs, I called them all and asked them not to endorse. Because they knew me and they didn't know him, I said, sure, we'll hold off, it sounds like a good issue. Let's see if he'll sign your pledge. So 15 of the 17 wouldn't endorse him, and it sort of became this big deal about, you know, why are you creating this ruckus? Why are you trying to make a big issue? And I thought it was a no-brainer. A Republican ought to expect its region at the University of Michigan to stand against political correctness and protect students' First Amendment rights. Long story short, the candidate came around, signed the pledge, ended up getting the nomination, and was elected and served for 8 years in that post. The issue there, or the example, had nothing to do with me trying to create an issue, but it had to do with the issue itself. And the fact that I was able to use a post and stand up saying, wait, you know, I'm going to step outside what people think the conventional use of this post is. I'm going to challenge the conventional wisdom. I'm going to challenge the establishment at the time. Another example during the same period, and I think Andy might have been involved with this, is as an officer of the state party, I published an underground newsletter criticizing the state party, criticizing every budget decision they made, criticizing every candidate they supported who didn't share my philosophical perspective, published the chairman's salary, and mailed this to every precinct delegate in the state. Of course, I didn't have my name on that. I used a euphemism, John Galt, which some of you may understand where that comes from. This got me into a lot of hot water. But again, I was using an opportunity to question convention, to question the common practice. And it made things better because it got the budget committee more involved in overlooking what state party had done and how they were spending their money. More oversight is always good for any organization. But at the time, it made me quite the rebel. Now, an example of when you can question the convention within the establishment, when I became executive director of the state party, all of a sudden I was the establishment, with one exception. During the 2004 campaign, when Bush was running for re-election, if you're working for a state party, you worked for the Bush re-election campaign, and you did everything the re-election campaign asked you to do. You did it when it told you to, how they told you to do, and you reported it in detail in a matrix. They were very top-down, centered authority type of approach to politics. They had us create a program called the 72-Hour Project, which was to change the way grassroots do politics, a complete radical departure. No longer were we going to wait until 3 weeks before an election start doing voter ID calls or get out to vote. We were going to start in February, okay, off year. And we were going to start then. And we were going to ask volunteers to hit certain quotas and phone calls every single week. Well, this was quite an abrupt change, and we had to go through a reculturing of our grassroots. After about 6 months of this, and the grassroots were hitting all of their targets, but they were starting to get tired out. And we're not even into the election year, and already the top-down approach had been hammering them and asking them to do things. Well, the president decided that Michigan was a target and that he was going to visit Michigan. And he did. He came here 14 times during this re-election campaign. And we had 10 other visits from either the First Lady or Cheney or other high-ranking officials. Those presidential visits consume a lot of energy. They also consume a lot of attention. And the standard convention and practice had been that when the president arrives, he's met at the airport by big donors and big elected officials. And when he's taken to the event site, he's then greeted by other big donors and other big elected officials. And then when he comes out into the crowd, the rope line around where the president's speaking is filled with big donors, big elected officials, grand poobahs of the party. And we need both our elected officials and our donors because they literally fuel the party. But one of the things that we had seen is that the grassroots had really stepped up and they had done what had never been asked before, but they weren't getting a reward. So we suggested on a conference call that they be allowed to supplement for those poobah spots when the president comes to visit. There was an audible just silence on a conference call with several other states. And when I thought they didn't hear me, I thought I was on mute, so I repeated it. And I remember the national field director saying, well, if you can have them show some sort of value at the event, maybe we'll consider it. What value? They've already been hitting their targets for 6 months. What else do you want them to do? So somebody else on staff, it wasn't my idea, came up with the idea of putting up a tent outside of the event, and the role-playing tickets would be given away to the first person that could complete 3 sheets of calls on site using a cell phone. We had a line for that tent, and donors showed up, and they had to make phone calls if they wanted to get a role-playing ticket. After the first event, and we made over 10,000 phone calls per hour, 3 hours leading up to the event, it was such a huge hit that all of a sudden the Bush-Cheney standard operating procedure for every state party became do this tent, have this line, have this procedure to have access to the roll call. All that to show that no matter where you're at in trying to make a difference, sometimes it's smart and wise to question convention. Sometimes convention is right and it's the best way to do things. Because as conservatives, we know we've learned from millennia of experience. But often, we sometimes just get tired of keep repeating things and doing them because that's the way we've done yesterday. So I cannot emphasize enough, it sounds oxymoronic to a bunch of conservatives, but to question convention, because I think more often than not, if you do so in the right spirit, the right purpose, I believe questioning convention.